Hello and welcome to the USGA Green Section webcast series. My name is Ty McClellan, Manager of Green Section Education, and I will be your moderator. With us today is our presenter, Mr. Patrick O'Brien, Director of the USGA Green Section Southeast Region. Patrick's webcast will be on the growing trend of painting the fairways. Patrick?
Thank you, Ty. Good morning and welcome to this USGA webinar titled Painting Fairways, A Better Option Than Ever Before. I'm Patrick O'Brien with the USGA Green Section Southeast Region, and I am so happy that you are able to listen to this webinar. Never in my wildest dreams did I ever think I would be discussing the topic of painting fairways. This is a topic that I thought only happened at the Super Bowl or at famous college football fields in the end zones. I was sure wrong on this prediction, and I hope you will enjoy this new idea that has really become quite popular these days in the Southeast region. The purpose of today's webinar is to provide an overview of this viable new alternative to fairway overseeding. This webinar is especially targeted for courses that overseed fairways. It is also targeted to courses that desire to provide color to dormant warm season turf fairways at sites without overseeding. It also may be practical now at public facilities to promote new business or at private courses to promote new members, as it is a true wow factor available within the budgets at many facilities. As you listen to what I have to say and learn more about painting, please be sure to take these thoughts into consideration. What might work for a course in North Carolina may not work for a course in Florida or Texas or Arizona. It is always an exchange of information to develop the optimum program for your course. There is an ever-changing stream of new ideas on this topic, and collectively everyone is evolving, but we are all on the right track. I hope the ideas in this webinar will be helpful to both experienced superintendents who have done this before and also to superintendents who want to learn more about painting. Golfers like to play on green grass. The fairway on the right is green and the fairway on the left is brown. Which do you like better? Even though dormant Bermuda grass can provide a good playing surface, many golfers feel the fairways are dead due to the brown color, especially at resort courses. The ability to provide a well-defined target with green fairway playing areas provides a heightened golf experience. Here is the typical dormant brown Bermuda grass fairway that happens during the winter season in the Southeast. The fairway mowing patterns have been burned into this fairway, and it does look good. But is something missing? It does play well, but without the green turf color, it lacks the presentation that golfers like when playing golf. No defined fairway target area either for the golfer to focus. Here is the wall-to-wall overseeding done, especially at resort facilities, to attract players who otherwise think the brown dormant Bermuda grass is dead. Market conditions dictate that this happens at resort courses, or golfers will play at other courses that do at these competitive resort areas in the Southeast, especially at Myrtle Beach, South Carolina. But I always ask these questions. How much does this cost? How does overseeding impact the fall golf conditions? Are golf carts restricted for many days in the fall due to irrigation practices needed to establish the ryegrass? And what is the impact on the health of the Bermuda grass the following summer? Fairway overseeding is much more common than the wall-to-wall overseeding, but I still ask the same questions about the impact on fall golf at these resort courses. Are the golfers happy with the impact of overseeding on fall golf? Overseeding is costly due to establishment techniques in the fall that are disruptive to the golfer. Frequent irrigation makes the fairways wet, and the young seedlings don't support the ball well until the spring. Turf colorants are a suitable replacement for ryegrass overseeding to provide winter color. Numerous products are now available for these programs, and especially due to the growing popularity of this new option. North Carolina State research done by Grady Miller reports that at the start of their study a few years ago, only 5 to 6 colorants were on the market, but today over 40 exist. Turf colorants are applied with existing spray equipment. Here is a picture of a painted fairway, and it is hard to tell the difference between an overseeded fairway. Painted putting greens have been done successfully for years in the golf business in the Southeast region. Superintendents and golfers are familiar with the use of paints on golf courses with this long, successful track record. The green color using the paints has worked well, and superintendents are very skilled with this technology today. Different shades of green are available to provide the fast and firm presentation, or deep green to provide the lush and wow factor. Painting tees also is now done at many Southeast courses to provide color to these playing areas. I really like this shade of green on this tee. It makes me want to tee it up now, seeing this beautiful tee. Look at how well these workers are at applying the paint and defining the borders. They are definitely having some fun doing this artwork. Well, quiz time. I know that I can't hear you, but you silently, when I show the following images, see if you can tell if the fairways are painted or overseeded to provide the green turf color. Paint or overseed? This is a painted Tiffway Bermuda grass fairway in the Hilton Head, South Carolina area. You can see the rough is still actively growing somewhat with the color, so the turf color in here is enhancing the winter leaf color at fairways. Paint or overseed? This is easy, as this is overseeding at Augusta National, where nobody does it better. What else can you say but perfection? Paint or overseed? This is a painted fairway, again in the Hilton Head, South Carolina area. Notice the uniformity of the green color and well-defined fairway borders. Paint or overseed? This is an overseeded fairway, and the mowing patterns are very well done. Paint or overseed? This is a painted Tiffway Bermuda grass fairway, again in the Hilton Head, South Carolina area. Paint or overseed? This is an overseeded fairway. Paint or overseed? This is a painted Bermuda grass tee. Paint or overseeded? This is a trick question. The tees are overseeded and the fairway painted. So a combination of paint and overseeding at playing areas at this golf course in the Hilton Head, South Carolina area. Paint or overseed? This is another trick question. The fairway on the left was colored with paint. The fairway on the right is overseeded. Obviously, the golf course was doing a test to compare fairway overseeding versus painting. Here is a picture of pattern mowing on dormant Bermuda grass in Atlanta, Georgia. No paint or overseeding, but impressive for sure. Here is paint on a pattern mowing fairway at another course in Atlanta, Georgia. The painted stripes are impressive and not due to any double painting at some areas or other smoke and mirror practice. The last quiz question, paint or overseed? All the key main playing areas here, fairways, greens, and green surrounds, have been painted to provide this presentation at a course in Atlanta, Georgia. It is truly impressive, and the members adore it. It is the first site that I have ever seen the green surrounds painted to. Let's use this chart to compare the impact of overseeding versus painting on fall golf playing conditions. Overseeding causes wetter soil conditions, minimizes ball roll, and golf cart restrictions happen. These are three things that I never want to hear from a starter prior to teeing off. The fairways are wet, mud balls will happen, and keep the golf cart on the path. Usually when I hear this from the starter, it is a beautiful fall day with sunny weather, and it hasn't rained in a month. With painting, the soil conditions are drier, lots of roll happens on the fairways, and no cart restrictions are enacted. The starter says to our group to have fun. Both overseeding and paint provide green turf color, the only variable that is the same in the fall season. Let's use this chart to compare the impact of fall overseeding versus painting on the golf course. Overseeding costs more, uses more water, requires more mowing, uses more herbicides. The impact on Bermuda grass health is variable and less consistency with seed establishment happens with the results dependent on weather, irrigation system, and establishment practices. Painting costs significantly less, in most cases 70 to 80% less than overseeding, uses less water, fertilizer, mowing, herbicides, and has no impact on the Bermuda grass health, yet provides more consistent results with proper application techniques. Also, the herbicides used for winter weed control are far more efficient with paint and less costly than those used for overseeding. Is painting sustainable? Yes. Fewer inputs are used, less water, fertilizer, fuel, and labor compared to an overseeding program. Fewer dollars are spent, and it makes golf more affordable. This improves the economics of the golf course. Customer satisfaction, it seems, is high with a product that meets or exceeds customer expectations. To make sure everyone is on the same page, let's define a few terms before I demonstrate some of the general principles of how to paint. Colorant is an overarching term that includes paints, pigments, and dyes. A colorant is used to change the color of the turf. Paint is a colorant that, when applied, it sticks to the outside of the painted surface. Pigments and dyes are an organic molecule formulated to enter the plant and color it from the inside out. The shirt you are wearing today used either a pigment or a dye to provide the color. Pigments stain the plant much the same wood is colored with stain. Let's talk about paints first and then pigments. Paints are a delivery system for applying color to a surface. Most paints contain a pigment, a binder, and a surfactant, and costs are usually between $40 and $50 per gallon. Paint would be the product used to change the color of a totally dormant fairway turf from brown to green. Paints hold up well to cold weather and frost due to the binding agents. Other additives help to hold the green paint color for extended times, and especially the yellow pigment due to its sensitivity to UV light. This is very important to keep the turf from turning blue. Here is a painted Bermuda grass fairway in the Macon, Georgia area. This fairway was painted in early March when it was totally brown, and the paint changed its color instantly to green. This picture was taken on a very cold day with a frost the previous night, showing how well the paint holds up to cold weather. Here is the paint or instant overseeding project used for a fairway painting program. It is concentrated from the container and once in the sprayer will be mixed with water at a dilution rate of 10 parts water to 1 part paint. Here is what you don't want to happen after painting a fairway. The green color fading to blue like the Boise State football field. Avoid the Boise State presentation at all costs for golf fairways, as your golfers won't like it. Dr. Haibo Liu at Clemson did turf colorant studies in 2005 and 2006. All the plots were green when painted, but as you can see, most plots have faded significantly to a blue color. Notice how the fresh coat of paint is green, but the old coat has faded to blue. Your golfers won't like a blue fairway. Here is how to avoid the Boise State effect. There are many turf paints available, and more are coming to the market every year. The buyer must beware. Talk to the paint manufacturer. Ask them if their paint fades to blue. Ask why or why not. Also, talk to researchers. Hybo Liu at Clemson and Grady Miller at NC State are experts on turf colorants. Finally, try a trial on your golf course. Moisture, temperature, and sunlight are the three main variables to color and fading issues. Dry weather, cold temperatures, and cloudy weather favor color retention. Selection of a light, fast, compatible yellow component in the paint is another key to avoiding the blue cast. Let's talk about pigments next. Pigments are an organic molecule formulated to enter the plant and color it from the inside out. Pigments stain the plant again, much the same wood is colored with stain. Master batch systems will be a new term for most. These products are the highest concentration of a homogeneous pigment, and examples include PAR and Forsum, but many other homogeneous pigments are on the market. Costs are typically at $150 to $225 per gallon. Since MBSs are concentrated pigments, they are much more expensive to manufacture compared to paints and tender very low profit margins for the seller. At locations with winter dormancy, MBSs don't last very long due to cold weather and frost. At sites where the plant isn't shutting down due to cold weather, these are more practical than paints due to mowing operations, and reapplication can happen at lower cost. MBSs should be applied prior to dormancy so they enter the plant because they are not made for dormant tissue. MBSs are also used all year round at some sites to provide color versus fertilizer, as spray pattern indicators, or after pesticide application to improve aesthetics. These products are also used as a touch-up between painting operations at dormant sites, at traffic areas and other areas where paint has worn due to their lower cost. When using MBSs on fairways to provide color, the initial treatment should happen in the late fall to actively growing turf with approximately 16 to 20 ounces of pigment per acre. This allows the pigment to get inside the plant when it is actively growing. Spraying every 14 days with a pigment and other products if needed can also be included, such as a wetting agent or fertilizer, etc., to maintain the desired fairway color. Pigment dosage varies from 4 to 10 ounces per acre on the repeat applications. Fairways will remain green throughout the wintertime using these products with repeat treatments on a timely schedule. If interruptions in the schedule happens, the pigments will fade and the golfers won't be happy. Here is a picture from a course in Florida using an MBS product at 14-day intervals. These fairways are actively growing most of the time, and mowing operations remove the pigment from the tissue. The fairway color using the MBS product has much better green leaf color than the fairway without the product on the left or on the right. Both paint and MBS products are acceptable alternatives to replace overseeding during the winter months, with paints preferred at colder winter climates. It all boils down to the climate and what look the clients are aiming to achieve and the budget. In areas of dormancy where overseeding is normally done, paints are a more successful option as they provide longevity. Fewer treatments are required for paints compared to the multiple treatments every 2 weeks or so with the MBS products. In areas where turf may cycle in and out of dormancy, using MBSs are a better option. When reapplied, A lower rate is usually required to achieve desired results. Also, combinations of both options can happen too. Paints may work well for the first half of the winter season, and switching to MBSs once the weather warms is a viable option. Here is a chart comparing paint versus the MBS products. Paints last longer, from 45 to 60 days after an application, and in the Southeast, usually 2 to 3 treatments occur to maintain the winter fairway color. Paints have excellent cold tolerance and can be used on both dormant and semi-dormant Bermuda grass. Paints are capable of turning dormant turf brown to green. Master batch products are short-term and usually last 10 to 14 days and usually require 8 to 10 treatments to maintain fairway color in the Southeast. Cold tolerance is poor, and they work best on actively growing turf to maintain the green color. Now, here is a flow chart detailing the general principles of applying the turf colorants to turf. Getting the product from the container to the turf can be challenging, and some steps are not intuitive, and especially the mixing and dilution step and the nozzle and calibration step that are highlighted in yellow. I will go through these 12 key steps in the general principles next. First, elevate the turf in the fall to 5/8 inch or slightly taller, as this increases the cushion for wear tolerance, playability, and as a canvas for the colorant. Especially when using the master batch products, apply the colorant before dormancy. Most paint programs are also started before dormancy. In this way, golfers will never see the brown fairway turf when starting in the late fall. Colorants are applied with the sprayer, and application usually takes 1 to 2 days. Colorants dry typically in 30 minutes. Step 1. Planning prior to embarking on painting fairways is essential and involves buying the product, transferring the product from the sprayer efficiently and without waste, setting up the sprayer with the proper nozzles and pump requirements, determining the painting rates, and calibrating the sprayer, and then preparing the fairways for the paint. Step 2, buying the product. Buy paint in a 250-gallon tote to save money and to reduce handling of the product. Buying paint in bulk saves money and freight. Smaller 5-gallon containers are also available for paint, and 1-gallon containers are available for the MBS products. Step 3, stirring. Due to the high viscosity of paints, stirring is essential prior to mixing with water to ensure the product will be in the proper chemical state. Stir the turf colorant in the 250-gallon tote with a 6-foot length and 1/2-inch diameter open PVC stick prior to transferring the paint from the tote to the measuring tank. A timer hooked up to the air compressor to start the stirring process early in the morning will have the product ready for use upon arrival at work. Shake or roll on the floor the small 5-gallon or 1-gallon containers to mix these up. Step 4. Transfer paint from the tote to a 5-gallon bucket. Use cardboard as a bridge to prevent any waste of the product. This is easy to do and a very efficient process. Smaller 5-gallon or 1-gallon containers, if purchased, can be directly added to the tank after stirring. Step 5. Adding paint to the sprayer. Transfer the paint from the 5-gallon bucket into the spray tank. Be sure to rinse out the bucket to remove all the product and to prevent waste. Add crop oil if necessary to help the paint adhere to the plant even better. Step 6. Add water to the spray tank from a nearby irrigation quick coupler. Add water to fill the tank to the desired capacity. Typical dilution rates are 9 to 10 parts water to 1 part paint. A full tank with the proper calibration will typically paint a total of 3 acres. Normal agitation devices in the spray tank will keep the paint at the proper uniformity. Step 7, nozzles. These are the paintbrush. Install the nozzles on the spray broom. The Greenleaf TDA 16 or TDA 8 nozzles used in this example have been very proactive in working with paint applications to provide uniform coverage given the unique properties of turf paint. Both nozzles apply the product at the same rate but with different spray patterns, helping to improve coverage on leaves with less streaking. The practice of turf painting is evolving rapidly, and I suspect there will be many more nozzle manufacturers that begin to compete for business in this area. A few tips on nozzles and calibration. Be sure to calibrate your sprayer with the paint because it has a higher specific gravity than water. Otherwise, the paint will come out of the nozzles at a lower rate compared to water. Again, calibrate with the paint, not the water, for accuracy of rates. Maintain pressure at the normal 40 to 50 PSI. Too much pressure causes finer leaf drops and drift. The proper green leaf nozzles will deliver a medium to coarse spray droplet, which is ideal for the painting process. 100% overlap happens with these nozzles, requiring one pass for proper coverage. As you can view on this image on a dormant brown fairway being sprayed with paint, the proper calibration and nozzle selection allows one pass to optimize coverage. This saves time versus two passes over an area that greatly adds to the time of getting this done. Step 8, pump modifications. The delivery pathway for spray products goes from the spray tank to either a diaphragm or centrifugal pump through the nozzles to the turfgrass plant. If using a centrifugal pump, replace the ceramic carbon seal with a low-cost Napa oil seal to prevent pump issues. The cost of this Napa seal is about $5. The cost to replace the spring-loaded seal on a centrifugal pump is about $300. No issues have occurred with diaphragm pumps. Step 9, preparing the turf. A clean turf surface is needed prior to painting. Use a blower to remove any leaves or debris from the fairway turf if necessary. Step 10, cover yardage markers. Cover the yardage indicator devices in the fairways with wooded covers. No need to cover the sprinklers in most instances since the paint products don't stick to these devices. Homemade wooded covers are easily made at a cost of less than $2 per cover. A total of 10 to 12 covers were made and are moved from fairway to fairway during the painting operation. Step 11, paint the fairways. Apply the paint to the fairway turf. It takes approximately 1 hour to apply the paint to 3 acres of turf. One application provides excellent plant coverage. Lining up the boom to define the edges is easy to do, and no special spray technique is needed for this step. Step 12, refilling the sprayer. Refilling the sprayer in the field will save time. Transport the 250-gallon tote or the 5-gallon containers on a wagon pulled by a tractor or cart. Add water to the sprayer from a nearby quick coupler. Precautions when painting. A few precautions to keep in mind. Make sure the turf plants are wet, or even better yet, have frost on the tissue prior to painting. Water is the catalyst to adhere the paint to the plant. Just like when using super glue, you always add water to activate the binding. A few cost-saving tips. Colors applied to turf with little background color, that is dormant turf, requires substantially more product to achieve the desired effect. When applied after turf loss has already occurred, 2 to 3 times more product was required to achieve the desired presentation. Start in the late fall and keep the turf green till normal turf resumes. We'll save money. The fairway on the left is a dormant fairway, and it takes a lot more paint to turn it from brown to green compared to the lower rate required in the image on the right that was in the semi-dormant condition with plenty of green tissue prior to painting. Painting works best on high-density turf canopies and includes all popular Bermuda grass varieties, all popular Zoysia, and Paspalum varieties. Paints don't work as well on common Bermuda grass due to its lower turf density, due to the less leaves and more stems, but it's still acceptable. The image on the left is a high-density Tifway Bermuda grass canopy where successful painting was done in the Myrtle Beach area. Keep golfers off the fairways for 30 minutes to 1 hour after painting. Keep golf carts in the rough for 24 hours after painting. The wheels on the golf cart, if turned sharply, can take the paint off the leaves more easily, it seems, the first day after painting. You can see the golf carts at this course in Macon, Georgia, off the fairways immediately after painting, but just for this day. Painted fairways provide spectacular, well-defined fairway playing areas, as you can see from this aerial view taken above this course in Macon, Georgia. Painting or overseeding won't hide poor drainage areas. Install drainage to improve presentation and playability of these areas for best results. You can see the cart damage caused to the painted areas due to the poor drainage at this site. Painting does provide a 10 to 12 degree increase of fairway soil temperatures compared to the non-painted rough turf. The green leaf tissue absorbs the radiant energy from the sunlight better compared to brown turf, and the soil warms up faster. The soil thermometer at the 4-inch depth at the painted fairway turf registered 72 degrees in the lower image compared to the dormant rough turf that measured 60 degrees at this course in the Hilton Head, South Carolina area. In most instances, superintendents have noted new Bermuda grass growth 4 to 6 weeks earlier at painted fairways compared to non-painted fairways in their area. This course tested painted fairways at one site in Alabama. I would say one thing that's going on here is that the painted fairway has already greened up because of the warmer soil, and this enhances the look even more. The non-overseeded, non-colored roughs and fairways on this course were only about 30% green. If a course is looking at starting a fairway painting program, I would provide some information to the golfers about this new best management practice program. Paints are chemicals. The safety and environmental impact of these chemicals are minimal. Golfers should have no health concerns playing on painted fairways. Occasionally, some paint may stain the ball, provided the shot hits the fairway, but it is easily removed with a towel and water. The paints are biodegradable and will not persist on the plants or the soil for longer than approximately 60 days. The end result is to make the painting operation natural, and hopefully most golfers won't really know how this green color happened. Here is an average annual cost chart for turf colorants at a course with approximately 30 acres of fairway. The number of treatments and rates are compared for paints and master batch products. With paint, the cost for 3 annual treatments using 300 gallons of paint range from $12,000 to $15,000, depending on the cost of the paint, at either $40 or $50 per gallon. With the master batch products, the cost for 10 treatments using 30 gallons of master batch pigment range from $4,650 to $6,750, depending on the cost of the master batch product, at either $155 or $225 per gallon. The per acre costs are significantly less with the master batch products, but the greater number of treatments needed will add to the overall cost. Again, it depends on your climate, on this important decision regarding which product will work best for your location. Are turf tolerance worth the cost? Each golf course will have to decide. At courses currently overseeding, a significant cost reduction is possible with the use of a turf tolerant program. At courses not overseeding, but desiring to enhance the winter presentation, a cost analysis can help with this decision. For example, a public course spending $15,000 for a painting program would need to increase play with a $30 green fee by 500 players over the winter months to break even. Over a span of 100 days in the winter season, an increase of 5 players per day. Summing up this topic, green is good, brown is bad, clubs are developing their own style of painting. I have yet to see two golf courses with the same painting program. More golf courses are using paint to enhance their winter fairway programs. Stay tuned for more information on this new trend. Thank you for allowing me to make this presentation, and I will be happy to answer any questions at this time.
Thank you, Patrick. That was a great presentation. For questions, I have a little bit different dashboard as an organizer, but as the attendees, you're all in mute-only mode or listen-only mode. There's a raise hand function. Either if you may see it right away, or you can see it in the attendee list. But if you'd like to ask a question, raise your hand. I will see that, and then I can unmute your microphone, and you will be able to ask your question. You can also type your questions in. And the first question, Patrick, we have one already. It goes back to the middle part of your presentation when you showed a slide of painted fairways at a Florida golf course. And the question from Brian is, what product was used for the application of those fairways, the photos you had from Florida? Do you recall?
I do know, Ty, that it was a master batch product. It was a pigment, and as you all know, there's quite a few pigments. I'm not exactly sure which one was applied in that particular case, but it was a pigment.
Okay, Mike Kenna has a question. It says, how well do the dormant fairways stand up to cart traffic?
Yes, the cart traffic holding up, so far so good from the courses in the southeast region that are painting or using pigments on fairways. You know, the paint tends to wear out. If traffic gets concentrated in some areas, it gets worn off the leaves. And sometimes, as I stated, sometimes some pigments are used to touch up these areas. But overall, the impact of cart traffic has not been significant. I would definitely allow the carts on the fairways, you know, during dry weather to allow this to happen.
Patrick, in your travels, we have a question from Lisa. It says, have you seen an increase or decrease of disease when using colorants?
I haven't noticed that at all. For example, in the southeast region, if we have our, you know, spring dead spot on the Bermuda grass or brown patch on the paspalum or the zoysia grasses, the clubs still need to keep up with their routine preventative programs. If disease is an issue, the paint won't have any effect.
Okay, Patrick, we don't have anybody with their hands raised yet. I just want to make sure that attendees, that you can find that link. Again, I can't see exactly the same dashboard that you have, but you should have the option to raise your hand, at which point I can unmute your microphone if you'd like to ask a question. I just can't tell you exactly where that option is. I think it's in the attendee list, or it would be in the primary menu up where you can ask questions, mute your microphone, minimize the dashboard altogether. Here's a question from Bud. It says, does the increased soil temperature cause more damage when late frosts would occur?
I have not noticed that. In my travels, as I stated, you know, these clubs are getting, grow so much sooner, and so far so good. It's only been positive results with the warmer soil temperatures.
Hey, Pat, I had a question for you. You said that it's good to paint when there's frost on the ground. Is that correct?
That is correct, Jim.
What do you do about the damage that the sprayer would cause spraying over frosted turf? I mean, how do they handle that?
Well, Jim, so far, with the frost and the painting that I've seen going together, we've not had any issues with tissue damage at all. It's worked well.
Patrick, I've got some more questions. Ross asks, do you see a problem with the underlying unpainted turf blades being ruffled and brought up to the surface due to traffic?
You know, the plants, like you say, with the guard traffic tend to get pushed down. But generally, unless it's a concentrated traffic area, the leaves tend to spring back. But I think overall the golfers have been, favorable with the lies on painted fairways. And, you know, in the late fall, letting the turf grow up a little bit to give you a little extra cushion there is also a big plus to provide that extra leaf tissue for better playability in the winter.
Yeah, and probably that extra leaf tissue would help absorb a little bit more of the colorant as well.
Right.
Another question, are courses using paints and pigments together to complement one another, or are they using them individually?
Well, I think they are using them together in some cases. For example, in the Myrtle Beach area, a lot of clubs start out using the paints initially. And then if it's a warm winter, say we start getting some growth during late January, February, I've seen clubs switch over to the pigments then for the remainder of the year when that plant starts growing again. And I think, too, some courses, they'll start with the pigments actually in the late fall. With the pigments absorbing the color there inside the plant. And then if they really go into good dormancy, then they may, in the middle of the winter, hit it with a paint application. And then they may come back, once the turf starts growing again, they may come back with a pigment. So I think combinations of both in some locations can work out very well.
Patrick, we have a question from Jeff. It says, are courses using pigments and Primo in late fall applications and possibly some fertilizer as well to get better color?
I have not seen that yet, but I think it's going to become more and more popular, especially I think, like you say, in some areas where you want to put the paint out and you really don't want to get a lot of extra growth when you put it out. You really want the turf to shut down a little bit so you don't have to reapply as much. But as of yet, I really haven't seen it much, but I think it's going to happen.
I am, Pat. I logged in as an attendee just to be able to see for sure where the raise hand emblem is. And for those of you that would like to ask a question verbally, in the GoToMeeting window that you see on your computer as an attendee, on the left-hand side, you'll see four icons, and one of them is a hand with a green arrow in it. And if you click on that and raise your hand, Ty will be able to see that, and then he can activate your microphone if you'd like to. You're obviously welcome to type in questions, but if you wanted to share, you know, perhaps you've painted and maybe you want to share that with somebody, obviously that'd be a lot easier to do verbally than typing it in.
Thanks, Jim. In the meantime, Patrick, and we hope we get some raised hands here soon. Patrick, in your travels, when you look at different golf facilities, what segment of the golf facility types are you seeing painting fairways? Is it just the private? Is it just the public? Are you seeing a mix of both? What are you seeing with your travels in your region?
Yeah. Ty, the trend started off approximately 4 years ago in the Myrtle Beach area at resort courses. As you know, with the economic conditions, a lot of the resort facilities were looking at, other viable means of applying color and reducing their operational costs. And, the use of painting and pigments, was tried by several of the golf courses, and it was successful. So it definitely first started in the resort area courses in the Southeast region. Some of the private courses now are becoming interested to, again, just to provide these targeted areas to provide better defined golf courses in the winter months. And also some public courses now are considering this as part of their program to see if it can help, generate more winter play by having something that their competition doesn't have. But the trend definitely started out at the resort courses first.
But there's no reason for you to believe that it can't work at virtually any golf facility type, that when their fairways go dormant, whether they're overseeding or not, if they wanted more green color and potentially attract more play during the winter, they would be a candidate to do this, correct?
They would be.
Yeah. We have one other question from Andrew. It says, do you think that a paint product will also raise the soil temperature like the pigments do?
Oh, actually, both pigments and paints raise the soil temperature since they, both color the turf green, and that causes that radiant energy from the sun to really heat up that soil. So the soil warming occurs with either paints or the pigments.
Great, and I hope everybody can see Jim Moore just created a poll. Jim, do you want to go into this?
It's pretty straightforward. I just thought it'd be interesting to see, how many people attending today had actually done this. And as far as the results of it, I think we'll let it run for a second, and then we'll close the poll. And I believe that'll let everybody view the results. Which I'll try that now. We'll see what happens. I'll tell you, in case it doesn't work, we haven't tried this before. 33% of the attendees said yes, 53 said no, and 13% said that they're considering it. So that gives you an idea, and that's with almost everybody voting, half the people voting. So,
well, good. I hope everybody votes. We have a question. Should caution? This is from Brian. Should caution be used when applying any of these on greens in conjunction with fertilizers, fungicides, etc.? Are there any conflicts with this?
I have not seen any concerns with adding, like I pointed out, either wetting agents or fertilizers. I believe, like you say, a lot of clubs use the pigments as indicators when spraying. Have done this for years, but you can check with the manufacturer of the paint or the pigment to be certain. But I certainly have not seen any interactions occurring anywhere in the Southeast region with these programs with mixing.
Okay, we have a raised hand. I'm going to go to Robert Boyer. I'm going to unmute your microphone now. Robert?
Issues that would you see if we painted our fairways in greens? I have ryegrass fairways and Ben Poa greens. Could you foresee any issues doing that through the winter months?
Was the question that you actually had cool season grasses?
Yes, that's correct.
I'll be honest with you. I mean, I've never seen the paints used on cold season grasses down here on the southeast. It's typically done, you know, on the fairways on the warm season. I just don't have any familiarity with that at all.
I mean, and basically, like you said, I mean, we're just trying to do something to set ourselves apart from our competition. I mean, because our ryegrass, I mean, it does, you know, go dormant. It does turn a little brown during the winter. Same with our bent poa greens. And, you know, anything that we could do to keep it green year-round would help us. So that's the basis of my question.
Sure. Well, I sure don't see how it would hurt anything, that's for sure. There's certainly going to be no impact on the plant health. In fact, if anything, it may help to, like you say, keep that soil warmer and keep that turf growing a little more actively than it would otherwise.
Robert, have you tried multiple iron applications? It looks like that might be, since you're, I know you go semi-dormant, but have you tried, you know, even, say, iron applications every couple of weeks?
No, I have not. I mean, one issue, obviously, we have, you know, we haven't had much this year, snow cover, so that becomes, you know, an issue with application. Pretty much application is my biggest issue, you know, being able to do it. I mean, some days, you know, with the colder temperatures, it would not lend itself well to any spray applications at all. But the multiple iron applications, I would certainly, you know, look into that, maybe even do a test on it to see how that would work.
Yeah, the reason I ask that is prior to the paints getting as good as they are, I know a lot of superintendents on dormant fairways would make anywhere from 2 to 6 iron applications throughout the winter. And I was always really surprised at how much of an impact on the darkness of the fairways that had, even though the turf was, you know, by all appearances, completely dormant. So with a partially growing plant, I'd bet you'd even see a greater response to it. I mean, that's just a guess, though.
Right. Thank you very much for the suggestion. I appreciate it.
Yeah, thanks, Robert, for the call. I'm going to go back and mute your phone again to cut out background noise, but if you have a question, you know, raise your hand again. We do have some more typed questions. We have David wants to know, when will the recording of this webinar be available online? My guess is we would have this not in this Friday's Green Section Record, but probably the next one, so 2.5 weeks. From today, we would likely have it available. Tim wants to know, how much does height of cut affect paint or pigments?
Well, I would say, obviously, like you say, you really want to have a good canvas to paint on with you know, the proper amount of leaf tissue. And in the southeast, you know, fairways, dormant Bermuda fairways are generally anywhere in the range of, you know, 5/8 to 3/4 inch. And, you know, with the rates that we're using and everything, it certainly is going to work well if that canvas is a high density, has good leaf texture, and is at that proper height, because you really want to have that height, especially for the wear tolerance and to be able to provide that good playability, you know, because you've got about 100 days of dormancy in most areas where I live, and so we want plenty of leaf tissue there to paint.
And you may have covered this in your presentation, and I missed it, but would a recommendation, Patrick, be that whatever height of cut you have in the fairways, let's just say it's a half an inch, to allow it to grow out just a little bit late in the fall as you're putting out your pigments and colorants to get a little bit more of that canvas?
That's exactly right. I mean, generally in the southeast, it's usually around Labor Day or, you know, sometime during mid to late September prior to the first frost. You know, that's when you have to get it elevated up there to the target that you want. Because, as you know, once you get that first frost, you know, the game's kind of over with adjusting that height of cut.
Yeah. Going back to the iron discussion we just had, Andrew asked, have you heard anyone using iron mixed with the pigments or paints?
No, I have not. I guess my thought on that would be, unless you need some iron, that, you know, these paints are going to do, or pigments are going to do just a wonderful job of giving you that that leaf color and that presentation that you want to dial in there. So, personally, in most of the spraying operations that I have seen, typically just either the paint or the pigment's going out. I seldom, to be honest with you, see much of anything mixed in with them.
Okay, Brian has a question. It goes back to the either turf canopy temperature or soil temperature, but he wants to know, how many degrees difference do you think you'd see when using pigments on actively growing turf, say in Florida? And the idea would be to help reduce frost or winter challenges on a member resort facility, trying to keep play at its maximum but not overseeding. What kind of temperature differences do you think you see there, Patrick?
Well, I mean, I think, you know, if that's going to correlate, you know, up here in the Carolinas and Georgia where I'm at, I mean, now this is at the 4-inch depth. We're seeing these, you know, between 10, 12, 15-degree differences between the colored areas versus the non-colored. Now, I would say I've never used an infrared thermometer, you know, to measure the canopy temperatures there. I've got to believe they'd be even a little bit warmer in most instances if the soil temperature at the 4-inch depth is 10 to 12 degrees warmer. So I would say this would be a benefit in helping to reduce some frosted tissue out there.
Pat, I would guess that maybe it doesn't decrease the occurrence of frost as much as it might speed up the melting of the frost.
Oh, well said, Jim. Yes.
Yeah, I think you're right. But to have that effect at a 4-inch depth or even a 2-inch depth with the soil, I would think there'd be some pretty major temperature differences at the canopy.
Yeah. Yes.
Yeah. Well, Patrick, we're getting a lot of nice comments that says basically, people aren't necessarily raising their hands, but we're getting a few comments of just thanking you for answering questions. I think many people have enjoyed the presentation and discussion.
Well, thank you. It was very kind of everyone to attend. I certainly enjoyed preparing this, and this is a really fun topic for me, and it's a nice new trend, and I think it's going to increase in popularity over the next few years.
Hey, Patrick, with that in mind, I know you're not against people contacting you directly as far as email is probably the best for you, but you might share your email address.
Sure. My email address is patobrien@usga.org. And I'd be happy to take any emails for sure and answer them.
Patrick, we do have one other question. This comes from Brian. He says, what product was used for the Florida application? And it was on the slide before you started discussing the seals. Does that ring a bell?
Yeah, I showed, you know, some pigment usage on a Florida golf course on a fairway, and then it was being compared to a non-treated fairway, just showing the greener color of the pigmented fairway and how it was keeping the turf down there on that Florida golf course more actively growing. And again, I know it was a pigment, and I know the applications were going out, you know, every 2 weeks or so, but there's so many pigments on the market, I cannot remember which one that they were using at that particular course.
Sure.
They're all good.
Yeah, sure. Hopefully, well, so Brian, that the answer would be a pigment, just not sure exactly which one.
Pigment, yes.
Hey, Ty and Pat, one other thing I just remembered. We had a couple of good articles recently in the Green Section Record on painting some of the work that Brian Whitlark has done with Kayamoto out in Arizona. And when we run the link to this webcast, and as Ty said, not this Friday's issue, but the issue 2 weeks from that, we'll be sure to include the links to the studies done out there as well.
Well, with no more questions, on behalf of all of us at the USGA, we'd like to thank you for joining us this morning. A special thank you to Patrick O'Brien, our presenter. I think this trend we are going to see is growing for all the right reasons, and as paints, pigments, dyes, colorants all become more and more sophisticated, and the techniques and all the information, just like Patrick has shared, we'll continue to see more of this going forward. So Patrick, thank you so much for sharing this to everybody today, and we look forward to comments and feedback. And as Patrick had already said, his email is patobrien, O-B-R-I-E-N, at usga.org. He'd be happy to answer questions, as all of us would. So again, thank you, and we'll talk to you again soon.
This has been another installment in the USGA webcast series. For more information on golf course management, visit www.usga.org and click on the Course Care tab.